the bezel. Welcome to another episode of Ticking Gray Bomb, Refined Taste for Idiots. I'm Mace. I'm joined with Mex with his fresh new strongman mustache.
What up?
He's really rocking it. And we've been working the Seiko angle quite a bit over the last couple, I'd say about a month. And we're just going to keep going to that well. In this episode, we're going to cover considerations for selecting a Seiko watch under $1,000. What we decided was we wouldn't pick any watches that are already in our collection or that we featured on the channel.
Yeah, and this is a way for you guys to give us some feedback in terms of if you'd like to see one of these showcased on the channel in terms of an unboxing or a review. Let us know in the comments below.
Right. So with that on the docket, Mex, do you want to go first?
Absolutely. And you're right, Mason. We've really been showcasing Seiko a lot. I think it really shows the breadth of their product line, particularly at these value price points. So the first one that I'm going to showcase is very much in that spirit. It's the Seiko SARY 229, the Presage GMT blue dial. It's a really attractive watch. It could be had for about $550 online. You guys know that I like Nomen watches in Singapore. That's my kind of JDM Seiko source. And this is indeed a JDM release. 40.8 millimeter diameter. So right in my sweet spot. It's a GMT watch. Okay. So it's a little thick, particularly by Mace standards, about 13 millimeters. So it has a little bit of girth on the wrist. Not terrible. 20 millimeter lug width, so lots of flexibility in terms of straps and bracelets. Unfortunately, it has a horlex crystal, okay? And I think that's one of the things that's holding me back from pulling the trigger. But it has this new 4R34 Seiko GMT movement, okay? So one of the other watches I'd like to showcase today also has that. This is a recent release by Seiko to kind of really have a budget GMT automatic option. I've seen them in Notice watches. You know, it's a micro brand. Also, Venezianico. They used to be Meccanica Veneziani, I think. But that proved to be a mouthful. And so they rebranded. But those kind of budget GMT micro brand watches are also using, I think, what they call the NH34, which is a private label. If you're not really a private label, but It's a Seiko 4R34 movement for non-Seiko timepieces. So that's my first. That's my first pick.
All right. Two things. 13 millimeters for Mace is not a big deal. It's these big ass chronographs that I have. This the Breitling that has sort of remained dormant for quite some time. It's just that's a truckload. And the second thing, you know, GMTs have come down in price. Because of the availability of movements like this, and Miyota also offers, so you're getting kind of GMTs at $1,000 or sub $1,000 that you wouldn't be able to, that a couple of years ago you would not have had the option to buy. So that's an exciting pick for Uncle Mex.
Excellent point, Miss. Really excellent point. Your first pick?
Yeah. So this is something that I wouldn't buy, but I really like the action on the dial. So it's the split second solar chronograph by Seiko. It's the one that looks like a droid. Honestly, the pushers and crown, it's just too much. But I like what's going on the dial. So I look at that. It's 42 millimeters across, lug to lug 48, and thickness just shy of 13. So I could pull that off for sure. That ranges. There are a couple of models there. The limited edition is $925, but the other three models are $850, I believe.
Okay.
So thought about it. Think it's cool. Wouldn't buy it.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I agree. I mean, it's got a cool look to it. The aesthetic of the dial is cool. But yeah, four pushers, I mean, it seems crazy. And as we've said before, I'm shocked that it's 42. I feel like this watch with those pushers should be in the vicinity of 45, 46 millimeters with some bigger wrist presence. I've never seen it in person. I'd be really curious to see how it looks. But yeah, personally, I don't think it'd be making its way into my collection either.
No, I'm going to double back. One watch that I really liked a few months ago was a Seiko 5 Sports Street Style Flieger in black. So it's got black case, black dial, and bright orange numerals, indices. Really had a cool look, but ultimately not enough for me to pull the trigger. Kind of a decent size, 39.5 millimeters, 48 lug to lug, 13.2 millimeters high, and only 360, the JDM model. So it's the SBSA 143. Noman had it for 360.
Yeah, love it. I love that. I love, there's something kind of exotic about JDM, models, right?
And I believe that is a day date complication. And so this I'm wearing a Seiko. We didn't do the wrist check, but this is 6139. And this has a kanji for the days of the week. So that's pretty cool.
Yeah, I love that. It's like my monster. I've actually specifically chose my monster JDM version so I can get English and the Japanese kanji. Yep. It's a very cool touch.
Yeah, absolutely.
In the spirit of a wrist check, so I'm wearing what Mace billed as Seiko's best release of 2023. This is the Black Edition Diver. Really nice piece. If you guys can see this here, I hope it's in focus. Really nice aesthetic. And ultimately, I stayed away from, there's one piece that I'll talk about shortly that I actually stayed away from the blacked out kind of PVD coated case because of this watch and my Citizen recently having come into my collection. I probably don't need three kind of blacked out watches.
And it's a great watch. I love that thing. The strap looks awesome. The stipple dial looks amazing. It's really great. Really great watch.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Mason.
You got it.
So my next piece is the Seiko Sarks. It's the SARX079. I chose the green dial, the Tokiwa, which I think looks like a baby Grand Seiko in terms of the aesthetic here. So I think it kind of great value from that standpoint. Looks like it's got the high polish, 760 on Noman. So certainly in the high end of price, I think that we're all going to look at today. It's much more of a dress watch, 39.3 millimeter diameter, 11.1 millimeter thick, 20 mil lug to lug. So you could definitely take the bracelet off and either dress it up or dress it down with a leather strap or a NATO. This has the 6R35 automatic movement. So it's a bigger boy than the Presage GMT. I think it's the same movement that's in this Black Edition Diver. It has a sapphire crystal. So this is really, we look up from jumping up from a GMT at 550 to this baby, if you will, I'm calling it the baby Grand Seiko at 760. About $200 price difference, but you're really into a high performance category, right? Great automatic movement, great finishing, and sapphire crystal. So this is where you start to get the good performance from the Seiko line.
So my next pick is the Seiko Time Sonar, the SRPJ45 and the SRPJ47. This pick is inspired by a vintage watch I had seen on DC Vintage Watches. And what's cool about it is the dial is transparent so that you can see the day and the date wheel. So it's a really cool feature. And these two replicate that. There was an earlier version, I think released late last year, where the dial was one third one color and two thirds a separate color. So the dial kind of split from 12 to 4 in one color and then from 4 to 12 in another color. And there were two versions of it. These two, the 45 and the 47, the dial is one color. So there's kind of a blue turquoise, and then they call it orange, but it's really a brown. And the bezel has that one-third, two-third split between two colors. Really interesting. You can kind of see the date and day wheel. And I just saw earlier this morning that Baum and Mercier has a similar watch called the Riviera. So where it's got a transparent dial that you can kind of see the date wheel working there. So maybe this is an emerging trend. Other watches like skeletonized watches or the open heart, you can see the inner workings. This is a milder version of that, I would say.
Agree. Yeah, and I think I can't remember. I think it might have been called the Lumen line with the Langa, right? Totally different kind of price range, but they also released something last year, if I'm not mistaken, that had that kind of transparent face, the dial, so you can see all the kind of the facial workings, if you will, right? The superficial workings of the watch. Kind of gets busy. I mean, it's really cool though. The model you showed me is cool. The downside is that you can get kind of busy, right? What am I really looking at? What are my eyes going towards? But it's a cool, it's definitely a cool look. And I would say that, you know, again, I think this is where, you know, we talk about Lange, we talk about Baum and Mercier. This is the great thing about Seiko is that they're innovating. They do some funky things and it's a really affordable price point. What was the price on this watch, Mason?
Yeah, $335.
Okay, so my next timepiece is an interesting one. I flirted with this, but in the end, I don't think it's going to be added to the collection. It's the Seiko SBDL095, also a JDM version. This is the, and so again, couple of models of this, color, couple of colorways. This is the steel case with a kind of Daytona Panda dial, so white dial and then black chrono registers. This goes for $479, also on Nomen watch. Couple of interesting things about this watch. It has a solar movement. It's a solar chronograph. Okay. It has a solar Seiko V192 movement. It's 41.4 millimeter diameter. So really nice size, nice wrist presence, 13 millimeters thick. So again, because of the chrono movement, it's a little thicker than maybe a time-only watch. So that, you know, one of the primary limiting factors of this watch is that it has 21 millimeter lug-to-lug width, right? Which really limits the variety of straps, bracelets that you can use with this timepiece. One of the pieces that we're going to be coming out with shortly is really talking about how you can spice up your watch, the aesthetics of your watch, make it feel like you have a new watch just by changing the strap. And 21 is a tweener. It's not 22. It's not 20. There are a lot of variety at those sizes. So this is kind of a watch out for me that would steer me away. But certainly for any of you who are looking for that Daytona look with a real credible watch company, not a knockoff, this is a good option to consider.
The lug width at 21, that's what my tag is. And, you know, if you go with 20, it's the spacing is very visible. The 22 isn't so bad. It doesn't bunch up that much. So that's what I end up doing with that watch if I go with the strap.
You'd have to do it. I agree, Mace. But it's you know, again, it's like, do I need, I mean, a lot of people don't, you know, won't notice something like that. I'm at the stage where I do because I have a lot of NATOs that are 22 or 20.
Right. My mom don't like a lot of people around.
When she come home.
I'm sort of cheating. I'm going to do a limited edition. I wasn't really planning on talking about this, but I think it is the best looking watch of the group of watches that I've picked. It's just a limited edition. So we're shying away. It's the Seiko Ultraman, which is a celebration of a cartoon from 55 years ago. I think it's really sharp. It's 42.5 millimeters in diameter. 13.4 millimeters thick, 46 lug to lug. It comes with the NATO, and the NATO has some writing on it. But I think this limited edition is better looking than the Otani limited edition. I just think it really looks cool, and it's only $400. I think getting it from Seiko, you know, you're not going to have any luck there, but I think there are some resellers out there on eBay that you can get it pretty close to that price. What do you got?
I agree. Max? Good price on this one. You know, again, like you said, Mace, limited edition, really attractive. You know, when I hear Ultraman, I think about that also limited edition Speedy, right? Or the Omega. Again, totally different price points, but if I can get into an Ultraman for $400, I'm there.
It doesn't matter who makes it.
That's
what does the Omega go for? Is that like, what's it, 25?
Yeah, it's in excess of 15. It's a big price tag for Speedy.
Right.
Yeah. So my last pick is kind of aligned with yours, or a pick that you made a couple picks ago. It's a Seiko 5 Sports GMT edition. So also kind of tied into my first pick. This is kind of sporty GMT, JDM version. So like the Seiko 5s, it's a little bigger, 42.5 millimeter diameter, 13.4 millimeter thickness. So again, because of that GMT movement, it has the same 4R34 GMT movement, 22 mil lug width. Okay, so it's again, little bigger watch, little broader presence. This, again, it's a Seiko 5. I expect that this is a Hardlex crystal. This is at a lower price point than the Presage. It's a $440. So I think there's probably better value here. There are two colorways. There's a blue face and a black face. I think I might be tempted in going to the blue face version. But yeah, just that's my last pick, Mace.
All right. So I went with a tried and true Seiko. When I kind of got back into the watch hobby, everyone was talking about the Seiko Alpinist, the Saab 17. The price was getting over $1,000 on Chrono 24 and other resellers. So what I picked was the Seiko Prospects Alpinist SPB 155, 157, 159, 39 millimeters diameter, 12.9 millimeters in thickness, 46 lug to lug. It's a handsome watch. It's 725. I think it's a really good pick. And I'm cheating a little bit by mentioning this, but there is also a GMT version of this watch. So that is the SPB 377 and 379. That I believe is coming out October 1st. So hopefully we get this video out before then. But that price point is around $1,300. So you can often get Seikos for below MSRP. I don't know that we're going to get below $1,000 on that one, but I had to mention it because that is a really handsome watch. So my pick for under $1,000 is the Alpinist. I think it's one of those classic Seiko watches, and just really love it.
Yeah, I mean, it's a good looking watch. I'm just looking it up here because that's news to me that it's coming out with a GMT. Alpinist is a, by all means, it's almost a cult classic, right? And you're right. It wasn't too long ago, 2 or 3 years ago, where Seiko announced, actually, there were rumors of the discontinuation and prices went crazy in the secondary market, right? They've done a good job with the reissue, the reimagine. Again, I'm just looking at this watch here. So we've talked a lot about GMT watches. This Seiko Alpinist has the 6R54 movement, the Alpinist GMT. So this is a big boy GMT movement, 3-day power reserve, automatic movement. You know, again, at that price point, you're going to get a lot of value and performance from Seiko. So this is an interesting pick. We may have to invest in this to profile.
Yeah. Yeah. This is a great one. And it's interesting. I've seen some white dial Alpinist ones. They're not so interesting to me unless you go way back to a vintage version where they have Alpinist written in red.
Yeah.
I think that's really cool. I wonder why they don't bring that that little detail forward in some of these more modern watches. I think that would really make it pop, especially the GMT watches are not, don't have white dials, but I think that could be a nice pop of color on some of these dials.
Yeah. You know, for me, you know, and this is very serious. I think this is like the Rolex Explorer 2 and the khaki, the Hamilton khaki field watch had a baby.
Yeah.
And it's actually, it's a good looking, it's like a pedigree, right? I mean, it's a good looking baby. Yeah. This is a really nice watch, Max.
Yeah, I agree. I really like the way it looks. So that's cheating, going above the $1,000 for the GMT version.
Yeah.
However, might be able to wheel and deal as we've done with a few of our, the Seikos in our collection, right? We've certainly done that. So those are our picks. Let us know what you think about them. What would you prefer under $1,000 from Seiko? We'd love to hear it. And if you like this video, like and subscribe. We'd really appreciate the support. Any closing words from Uncle Max?
You know, Seiko is a great brand, great heritage, and they're constantly innovating, right? At different price points. So I think we showed you a wide range of watches, complications, prices. You know, again, I'm curious to hear what your thoughts are. What's part of your collection? What would you like to add? Because at the end of the day, Seiko, regardless of where you fit as a watch collector, I think Seiko, it deserves a part of your collection.
Absolutely.
Bye-bye.